you are interested in military tech, which I think is safe to assume as you're watching this video, you might have been wondering why the US Navy, which is by far the largest in the world, who has a budget that far surpasses any other nation in the world, does not operate any supersonic anti-ship missiles. Right now, the US Navy's main anti-ship missile is the Harpoon. It's a relatively older missile, designed nearly half a century ago, and has a range of only 130 kilometers and flies at subsonic speeds, slower than the speed of sound. We regularly see supersonic missiles from Russia, things like the P-500 and 700 ship-launched missiles, or the air-launched KH-22 and KH-41. Relatively smaller countries have also developed their own supersonic anti-ship missiles, like Japan, India, and Taiwan. So it begs the question, if these nations can build them, why doesn't the US? The short answer is that there is a lot more to a good anti-ship missile than just speed. Speed does help. It reduces the amount of time that your enemy has to defend itself. If, in a perfect world, you have two missiles that are exactly the same, but one flies twice as fast as the other, it would mean that the enemy has only half as much time to mount a defense. But in reality, there are several issues with speed alone. 1. Faster flying missiles tend to fly higher in altitude. The atmosphere is thicker the closer you get to the surface. This creates much more friction and drag. If you want your missile to fly at low altitudes, you are going to be sacrificing speed or range or have to build an enormously large missile to achieve this. The reason flying low is important is because the Earth is not flat. Therefore, you are limited to how far away you can see an object that is flying close to the surface. This is called the horizon. For ship-based radars, mounted, say, 20 meters above the surface, it would only be able to detect an anti-ship missile flying at, say, 10 meters above the surface, at a maximum range of about 31 kilometers. As you increase the flight altitude of the missile, that detection range increases. At 100 meters, the range is 60 kilometers. At 1,000 meters, that range is nearly 150 kilometers. So there's a trade-off between range, speed, altitude, and the size of the missile that you must choose between. The KH-22, for example, is a large, air-launched missile. It flies at over 4 times the speed of sound, and has a range of over 600 kilometers. But to do this, it flies up to an altitude of around 30 to 40,000 meters. If we were to go back to our horizon calculator, we can see that it could theoretically be detected over 800 kilometers away. Despite its speed, this gives the defender more time to prepare a defense, and also gives them multiple opportunities to attempt to shoot it down. Compare this to a low-flying missile, which can only be detected 31 kilometers away at maximum. It may be traveling 1/5 the speed of the KH-22, but can only be detected at 1/27 the distance. This gives the defender much less time to react than the supersonic missile. With that being said, low-flying supersonic missiles have been developed, such as the P-700 Granite. As I said though, to do this, you need to give up another feature. What the P-700 gives up is size. It is huge, weighing up to 7,000 kilograms, compared to the US's Harpoon, which weighs less than 700. The P-700 also flies much slower than the KH-22. Mach 1.5 at low altitude compared to Mach 4 for the KH-22, and flies somewhat higher than the Harpoon, at around 50 meters instead of 10. Because of its large size, only the largest vessels can handle it. The Kirov-class battlecruisers, the largest ship at sea today, besides aircraft carriers, and the Oscar-class submarines, the largest guided missile submarines in the world, besides the converted Ohio-class, which were originally ballistic missile subs, and Russia's aircraft carrier, the Admiral Kuznetsov, can fire the P-700. Another factor when considering what makes a good anti-ship missile besides speed and flight altitude is how smart the weapon is. Most long-range anti-ship missiles are launched in a specific direction for a predetermined amount of time, and then turn on their radar and lock on the first thing that it sees. The problem is, the enemy could have moved, or chaff and decoys could throw it off course, at which point it could potentially hit a civilian or a friendly ship. Smarter anti-ship missiles are able to distinguish between targets to know what to hit. Also important is maneuverability. A problem with supersonic missiles is that their high speed makes them less maneuverable. The reason this is important is because many ships are armed with point defense weapons, such as the US Phalanx or the Russian AK-630. These super-fast automated guns fire at high rates of speed in attempt to shoot these missiles down. Weapons such as a harpoon will perform a maneuver right before it hits its target, making its flight path unpredictable, and more difficult for these guns to shoot them down. While some supersonic missiles will perform some sort of terminal maneuver, it does so much more gradually, over a longer distance due to its speed, making the maneuver less effective against point defenses. So there are many factors to consider beyond just speed. Even Russia, who has many different supersonic anti-ship missiles, has been developing and deploying new subsonic missiles. The KH-35, for example, entered service in 2003, decades after those supersonic missiles like the KH-22 and P-700. It is similar in many ways to the US Harpoon. It's close in size, weight, warhead, speed, and range. It has been deployed to numerous launch platforms too. Aircraft, ships, submarines, and even land-based sites. Other countries have also been developing subsonic anti-ship missiles. A Norwegian company has recently developed the Naval Strike Missile, another subsonic weapon that several nations are planning on purchasing. Japan developed and began operational service of the Type 12 in 2015. Turkey just finished the SAM subsonic missile, and China continues to produce subsonic anti-ship missiles for their navy. So it's a lot more complicated than just comparing the ranges and speeds on Wikipedia, like many YouTube videos I've seen seem to do. In some cases, subsonic missiles are better than the supersonic ones. But still, why doesn't the US build a supersonic anti-ship missile? First, it's not like the US is incapable of designing and building supersonic weapons. They have in the past and still do today. In fact, they built their own sea-skimming, supersonic anti-ship missile that they use as a target to shoot down while testing their missile defense systems. The missile is called the GQM-163 Coyote. It has a range of over 80 kilometers, can fly up at altitude to simulate weapons such as a KH-22 Kitchen, or a sea-skimming level 5 to 10 meters above the surface. It flies at over 2.5 times the speed of sound, and it can be programmed to perform maneuvers in its terminal phase, something that many modern anti-ship missiles do to avoid Defender's point defense system, as mentioned earlier. One issue for the US is launching platforms. Most supersonic anti-ship missiles are large, requiring specialized launchers to be made. The US has been building and operating the same destroyer class for almost 30 years, the Arleigh Burke class guided missile destroyer. A small exception to that is a Zumal class, which large-scale production was cancelled mostly due to budgetary issues. While the Arleigh Burke has gone through a few different variants, its weapon capacity has remained mostly the same. That is 90 or 96 Mark 41 vertical launch cells. Just a side note, if you're a nerd like me and wondering why the difference, the older variants of the Arleigh Burke class had a crane that was used to help reload the VLS cells. Those took up 3 cells, one crane for the front VLS and one in the back, taking up 6 cells total. The newer variants remove these cranes, allowing those cells to carry missiles. This system works great. It can accommodate many different types of missiles, land attack cruise missiles, surface-to-air missiles, anti-submarine rockets, etc., compared to having different types of launchers for each different type of weapon. The problem, though, is that any weapon you want to design in the future is constrained to the size of these cells. In some cases, this works. The Evolve Sea Sparrow missile, for example, a surface-to-air missile designed to shoot down enemy aircraft and cruise missiles, is smaller, and 4 of these can be placed into each cell. But when it comes to long-range, supersonic weapons, which I mentioned earlier tend to be much larger, they might not fit. So if the US wants to design such a missile, it would have to either make it smaller, sacrificing range, speed, or abilities such as sea skimming to make them fit, or they would have to construct an entirely new launch system to fit these larger missiles. That means either modifying the Mark 41 VLS, removing it altogether to make room for larger weapons, or start from scratch and design an entire new class of ships. This is a problem that Russia, for example, has not had, as their ships were designed from the beginning to carry these larger anti-ship missiles. Ships like the Kirov-class battlecruisers and the Slava-class devote large sections of the ship to carry these weapons. In the case of the Slava, which are each slowly undergoing a refit, they are able to accommodate new supersonic anti-ship missiles because the infrastructure is already there. The Marshal Ustinov, a Slava-class ship, will now carry the new P-1000, which replaces its older P-500 missiles. Along similar lines, the US Navy has been shaped by the enemies that they have been fighting. For the last 30 years, the US has mostly faced off against unorganized, relatively lightly armed terrorist organizations. Groups like Al-Qaeda and ISIS do not have a navy, and therefore weapons such as anti-ship missiles are not useful. Instead, we have seen a huge increase in the design and production of slow-moving, unmanned aerial vehicles, or drones, as these weapons are ideal to handle the threat that they pose. These drones do not work well against an enemy with a credible air defense. But since these groups do not operate any surface-to-air missile systems to shoot them down, they work well. Even when the US fought against another nation with a functioning navy, like Iraq or Libya, those navies they faced consisted of mostly older, less capable ships. Older weapons like the Harpoon or even guided bombs were more than enough to counter these countries' naval forces. Even when we go back to the Cold War, where the main threat to the US, the Soviet Union, had the second largest navy in the world next to the US, the doctrines differed greatly. The US had a large fleet of aircraft carriers which were able to launch attacks nearly anywhere in the world. The Soviets' naval doctrine was different. With its relatively smaller fleet of aircraft carriers and warships, the Soviet Union could not do the same. They did not have the funding or ability to do so. Instead, they focused on a bastion defense strategy. That is, highly defending specific areas, usually close to their homeland or near their allies. To do this, they poured a lot of money into researching, developing, and deploying large numbers of anti-ship missiles so that they could overwhelm US naval ships and carriers by simply throwing more at it than they could handle. They developed massive numbers of launch platforms to launch these missiles. Ships, bombers, submarines, land-based systems. They even developed a whole new class of ships called missile boats. These are small, fast boats armed with virtually nothing but two or four anti-ship missiles that would speed out into an area, fire their missiles, and then turn and speed away. The Soviet Union built hundreds and hundreds of these missile boats. Basically, the Soviet Navy was more defensive in nature, with their ships armed with weapons designed to counter US ships, compared to the US Navy focusing more on a large fleet of aircraft carriers and eventually land attack cruise missiles to attack targets on land. With all this being said, the US has just now begun to change course to developing new anti-ship missiles. Much of this can be contributed to the rise of the Chinese Navy, who is currently building up a large fleet of destroyers and even aircraft carriers, which threatens the US dominance in the Western Pacific Ocean. New weapons are currently being developed. One of the most popular of these is the LRASM. While it is not supersonic, it is stealthy and flies low, close to the surface of the water. As mentioned earlier, this means it cannot be detected until it is very close, and its stealth features make it even harder for the ship's radar to detect, even after it is above the horizon. Also, being stealthy makes it more difficult to be detected by other platforms, such as AEW aircraft, by other aircraft flying overhead, or other ships. It is also a very smart missile, using some pretty advanced technology, such as artificial intelligence. This allows the missile to react to any defensive measures the target might take, such as maneuvering to avoid missile defenses, jamming radar signals that might detect it, avoiding chaff and decoys, and using onboard sensors to target specific ships and specific points on that ship. As mentioned earlier, older anti-ship missiles are not smart and will pretty much lock on to any radar return it finds. It could hit a civilian vessel, or potentially even a friendly ship, especially over extremely long distances. The LRASM eliminates this. The missile has already gone through numerous tests and is now operational, and is being bought by the US Air Force and Navy. Another weapon is an upgrade to the Tomahawk cruise missile that allows it to hit ships. The US used to have an anti-ship variant of the Tomahawk, but removed it a few decades ago. Part of the reason was what I just mentioned. Over such long distances, you had no control and no idea what it was going to hit. Both of these are still subsonic though. There was a plan to create a supersonic variant of the LRASM, but that seems to have been cancelled. One interesting story did come out recently though, that could shed some light into a new anti-ship missile being developed by the US. Last summer, a story came out about China hacking a US naval contractor. Through this story, we learned of something called the Sea Dragon, a previously secret program in development by the US. We do not know exactly what this program is, but there have been reports the Chinese stole data on U.S. development of a secret supersonic anti-ship missile that would be launched from U.S. submarines that would be operational in 2020. Unfortunately, we really do not know much more, as details have been withheld due to national security concerns. And finally, the U.S. actually does have a supersonic anti-ship missile currently in service. A few, actually. Some variants of the SM-2, SM-6, and the ESSM surface-to-air missiles have the ability to hit ships. These are, however, not designed solely for that purpose. They have a tiny warhead, making them less than ideal as an anti-ship weapon. The SM-2 has actually been used in combat against ships. In 1988, the US fired 5 or 6 at an Iranian missile boat. They did disable the vessel, but it did not sink. While it is useful to have the secondary feature, these missiles are not a viable primary anti-ship weapon. To be clear though, with all this being said, this does not in any way take away from the incredible anti-ship missiles Russia and the Soviet Union before it built. They have developed arguably some of the most advanced and powerful missiles in the world. In fact, Russia has developed an anti-ship missile which is able to balance range, speed, altitude, and the size to an amazing extent. The weapon is called the 3M54 caliber. It has a similar size and weight to the US Tomahawk. It has a good range and flies very low to the surface. The fascinating trade-off is that certain variants of the weapon fly at subsonic speeds for most of its flight, enabling it to have a longer range. Then, when it gets closer to the target, in what is called its terminal phase, it will boost up its speed to several times the speed of sound. It's a pretty interesting design that has found a good balance between features and capabilities. So basically, the difference between the US and Russia simply comes down to their different naval doctrines. The US has been primarily unmatched when it comes to number of ships and aircraft carriers, and used their navy more as an offensive strike force, whereas other countries have not been able to do this, and turned to a more defensive doctrine and used their navy to counter the US's fleet. But with the sudden rise of the Chinese Navy, the US will have to shift their strategy to counter this threat. So it is possible that very soon we will see a supersonic anti-ship missile in service in the US Navy very soon.